This is Eddie Cantor. You may think you are listening to just laughter and applause, but to comedians, it's food and drink. It's oxygen. It's life. There have been many comics contributing to America's laughter. Now I'd like to present the actual voices of some of the greatest comedians of the century. When I was in the Ziegfeld Follies of 1917-18, my buddy was W.C. Fields. We roomed together on tour. Oh, he was a lot of fun. W.C. Fields was truly one of the greatest comedians of the century. When someone said to him, "Say, Bill, why do Eddie Cantor's eyes pop out like that?" He said, "Young man, let me tell you something. If you got up one morning and found yourself the father of five girls, your eyes would pop out too, yes indeed." The late W.C. Fields had a following that even now hasn't deserted him. They flock to see his old movies, haunt music shops for recordings, and collect stories about him. You'll know why when you listen to this.
Give me a little pianissimo, Professor, please. I would like to speak a few words on temperance. That's fine. Keep it down there. Ladies and gentlemen, down with rum. Ever since the beginning of time, there has been a drink problem. Quite a problem. Even a greater problem now. So scarce. Throughout the Middle Ages, the use of liquor was universal. And drunkenness was so common, it was unnoticed. They called it the Middle Ages, because no one was able to walk home unless they were between two other fellows. I was usually the middle guy. But through the years, enlightenment came, and with it, the control of spiritus fermenti. And controlling spiritus fermenti is tougher than tying a hair ribbon on a bolt of lightning. That's a good simile. Now, before I go any further, please do not labor under the misconception that I always have been a teetotaler. No. In my younger days, I was prone to take a nip. I chortle now at the former weakness in my otherwise strong character. But how well I remember my first encounter with a devil's brew. Devil's brew. I happened to stumble across a case of bourbon, and I went right on stumbling for several days thereafter.
That was W.C. Fields and some of his humor. When Howard and Howard started out as a team, President Roosevelt began his second term. No, not Franklin, Teddy. The year was 1905. I was 13 years old at the time. In those days, food was a luxury, but I'd pass up eating any time to buy a ticket in the balcony of Tony Pastor's theater and laugh myself silly at Howard and Howard. I can see them now. Gene played the part of a salesman. Willie a porter who staggered under the load of the salesman's six heavy suitcases. "Hurry it up," Gene would say, "or I'll get myself another boy." Willie would gasp, "You could use another boy and a horse besides." Ah, me, 1905. Wheat kept America alive, but corn kept the comedians going. Here's a sample of the kind of comedy that made Howard and Howard headliners in vaudeville, stars in musical comedy, and the hit of many a Winter Garden show.
Well, Sammy, what did you think of the opera?
An opera, schmopper, opera. There wasn't a joke in it.
And the fellows that backing me were talking, it was terrible. One fellow was talking about his heart, one fellow was talking about his liver, another fellow was talking about his lungs. That wasn't an opera.
No.
That was an organ recital.
Yes. Well, have you an ear for music?
A what?
I say, have you an ear for music?
I don't know. Take a look and see. I got a drum in there.
No, no. I mean, you were playing a musical instrument.
Sure, once I had a grand piano.
You had a grand piano?
Yeah, but I lost it.
You lost it?
Mm.
How can anybody lose a grand piano?
I stopped payments on it.
Oh, yes. Well, you know the whole trouble with you, Sammy, is your education has been sadly neglected.
Neglected.
Yes.
Listen, I went to college and I would have graduated with high honors only for one thing.
What was that?
The day of examination, the fellow in front of me got sick.
Oh, he did.
Yes.
Well, high in arithmetic.
Fine.
You are?
Yes.
Well, I'm going to try you.
Go ahead.
How much is 10 times 10?
Quick. 90.
Why 90?
Ain't you a friend of mine?
Well, what's that got to do with it?
I always knock off 10% for friends.
Howard and Howard, favorite funnyman as far back as 1905. Cigar-smoking George Burns and zany Gracie Allen crashed the big time along with that other big crash back in 1929. And they've been going strong ever since. If you think some of the things that Gracie says professionally are funny, you should hear some of her cracks in private life. One night she called and invited me to a birthday party for George. I thanked her and asked, is it to be a surprise? Gracie said, I'll say it's not even his birthday. George is the best straight man show business has had in the last quarter of a century. It's Gracie who gets the laughs, but it's George, the wonderful pin boy, who sets him up. Yep, Burns and Allen, the perfectly mated couple on or off stage. Here they are in one of their early vaudeville routines.
Well, Gracie, say hello to everybody.
Hello, everybody. What do I do now?
Well, just make something up, you know.
Oh, all right. I'll make up a riddle. I'll give you three chances, and if you can't guess it, you win.
If I can't guess it, I win? Well, what happens if I guess it?
Well, then it's a tie.
It's a tie?
Now, what's the difference?
Just a minute, Gracie. This one is on me. A fellow was in a restaurant. He ordered spinach, mashed potatoes, and cheesecake. How did I know that he was a soldier?
Oh, is that the one where the fella had on a uniform? Yeah, that's very good, George. Tell us.
What I'd like to know is how do I allow myself to get mixed up into these things?
Oh, that's very funny. Now, I'll make one up. Not only can I make up riddles, George, I can also tell you what you're thinking about. I'm a mind reader.
Listen, Gracie, is there anything that phases you?
I don't think so.
No.
All right, now, think of something.
Well, all right, I'm thinking.
Is it green?
Is what green?
Does it hang from the ceiling and whistle?
Does what hang from the ceiling and whistle?
Does it run along the floor and sing?
Listen.
Does it climb up buildings and swim?
Just a minute. I thought you said that you could read my mind.
Well, George, how can I read your mind if you keep on asking me all those silly questions?
I'm asking. Listen, let's talk about something else. Well, Gracie, I'm sorry to hear about your missing brother.
Oh, that's too bad, George, because my brother's missing, too.
The only difference between you and me is that I have the power of mind over matter, and you have no mind, and it doesn't seem to matter.
Oh, I bet you tell that to all the girls.
Never mind. I still would like to know, how is your brother?
My brother? Oh, well, I think they ought to open up all the prisons. It would help prosperity.
Wait a minute. That's the wrong answer.
No, that's the right answer, but you asked the wrong question.
That was just a hint of the happy nonsense George Burns and Gracie Allen have been contributing to Mr. and Mrs. America for over 25 years. There never was anyone in America or in show business exactly like Will Rogers. He was cowboy, philosopher, humorist, all rolled into one. More important, he was a great American. We were together at the Ziegfeld Follies. One matinee, while watching the shapely Ziegfeld girl strutting across the stage, Will said, "Gosh, Eddie, they can't do a thing, but ain't it fun watching them do it?" And talk about ad-libbing. One time when Rogers went on, the audience started laughing even before he opened his mouth. He couldn't understand why until he turned around and saw that a cat had followed him out from the wings and sat directly in back of him. This quick, Will said, "Get out of here, pussy. This is a monologue, not a catalog." Here's Will Rogers and some more of his humor.
somebody come along with a plan to plow under part of the cotton. And we did, and other nations like Brazil found out where we plowed it under, and they come and dug it up, and now they've got more cotton than we have. Somebody had a plan to teach hogs birth control, and now it's a habit with them. Somebody had a plan to plow under every third acre of wheat, and the wind come along and blew out the other 2 acres. It was all a fine plan, well carried out. We wanted to raise commodity prices, and now we find there's more people eating than there is raising. And if you get things too high, the guy that eats is going to come and hollering, you know? And our own downright conscience tells us that there's no reason why anybody should have more than you. There ain't nothing wrong with the plan, only just one little defect. Nobody ain't gonna share it with you, that's all. I know a lot of tremendously rich people that should share their wealth with me, but they just don't see it my way. Then I know folks that ain't got as much as I have that think I ought to share with them. Well, I just can't hardly see it that way either, you know? That is, even if I can see it that way, I'm not doing it out of...
Oh, how we could use a Will Rogers today. His logic might clear up a lot of today's confusion. When women wore hobble skirts and Henry Ford started mass production on his Model T, yours truly was a singing waiter in Coney Island. The year was 1909. Geez, old. Playing piano for me was a young lad by the name of Jimmy Durante. Even then, he had a language all his own, and he's never changed. Recently, I asked Jimmy to take a plane with me to Las Vegas. He said, "Eddie, I ain't flying. If Mother Nature wanted me to fly, she would have made me with feathers." Now, Schnauz and one of his own creations, Ink-a-dink-a-doo.
Ink-a-dink-a-doo. A dink-a-dee, a dink-a-doo. Oh, what a tune, what a tune for crooning. Ink, a dink-a-doo, a dink-a-dee, a dink-a-doo. It's got the whole world spooning. Eskimo bells up in Iceland are ringing. They've made their own paradise land singing. Ink, a dink-a-doo, a dink-a-dee, a dink-a-doo simply means ink, a dink-a-dee, a dink-a-doo. Ink, a dink-a-doo, a dink-a-dee, a dink-a-doo. Ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-boo. Just a crooner, just a crooner. Ink, a dink-a-doo, a dink-a-dee, a dink-a-doo. There's a little bit of Bing Crosby in me. Eskimo bells up in Iceland are ringing. Come on, Jimmy, here comes the finish. Pep it up, hit it! Ink, a dink-a-doo, a dink-a-dee, a dink-a-doo. What a voice, what a voice. Simply means ink, a dink-a-doo, a dink-a-dee.
That was Jimmy Durante with Ink-a-dink-a-doo. You know, if we weren't in show business, Jimmy and I would have made good in politics. Why, with my eyes and his nose, what I couldn't see, he could smell. New Mexico and Arizona were admitted as the 47th and 48th states. The American flag had two more stars, and the American stage sparkled with two bright comedy stars, Weber and Fields. This team not only owned their own theater, the Weber and Fields Music Hall, but employed such immortals as Marie Dressler, David Warfield, William Collier, Lillian Russell, and, oh, so many others. They created routines that found their way into musical comedies, revues, and burlesque shows. Both Weber and Fields were born and raised on the east side of New York. That's what made their material so funny when I caught their comeback at the Palace Theater some years ago. Fields started bragging about his background. "Joe," he said, "I come from a very rich family. We had a governess, a chauffeur, a butler." Weber said, "Don't kid me, Lou. I happen to know where you lived. You were dispossessed so many times, had your furniture put out on the street so often, your mother finally bought curtains to match the sidewalk." Here now are the actual voices of Weber and Fields in part of a typical sketch that had Grandma and Grandpa rolling in the aisles in the early 1900s.
I got the right to argue.
Why?
Why, I want to know what you investigated my money in.
As a friend, I will tell you. I investigated your money in the Mosquito Trust.
A Mosquito Trust? Now I know I'm going to get stung. I own $10,000 worth of mosquitoes. By gracious, I didn't think all the mosquitoes in the world was worth that much.
You don't own the mosquitoes. You've only got an interest in them.
That's the first time I ever took an interest in them. But how comes the profit?
Ah, that's the point. You see, we got a farm in New Jersey. Would you believe it? The last time I was up there, I counted over 7 million mosquitoes. Now you can see in how a short time we will be able to control the market. And if anybody wants any mosquitoes, they'll have to come to us and pay us our price.
Well, how could you control the mosquitoes?
Our mosquitoes will do anything they're told. And besides, the agent goes from house to house and says, "Good morning. Would you like some nice fresh mosquitoes today?"
Well, do any of them bite at it?
Of course not.
But then where comes in the business?
If they say no, then we sign a contract with them for $500 a year to keep the place clear of mosquitoes.
And yet I don't see it.
Then we go to the head mosquito and we give them the name and addresses of all the people who don't sign. And the next day, a flock of mosquitoes go up there and give them a sassy bite.
They're going to lose some of the mosquitoes that run away and bite hither and thither as they see like it?
No, why should we? Don't we treat them right and let them eat with the best families?
Oh, that's wonderful. I didn't know before that you could tell how a mosquito would act. But say, couldn't I pay a little more money and buy a couple of lightning bugs so I could see what our mosquitoes were doing at night?
That was the famous team of Weber and Fields, important in the Americana of comedy. Unquestionably, the greatest storyteller in the last half century, as far as I'm concerned, is Harry Hirschfeld. He has more stories than the Empire State Building. Harry started life as a cartoonist for the Hearst papers in 1910, the year women wore sweaters to their knees. Now, who would look at a sweater below? Well, back to Harry Hirschfeld. His original cartoon was called Desperate Desmond and had fair success. Then he changed it to Avy Kabibble, and both Harry and his cartoon were the rage. So much so, the Hammerstein Theater engaged him for an appearance, and from then on, Harry Hirschfeld was a performer. Even today, Harry attends not less than 150 functions every year. I have spoken on the same platform with him and prayed that I wouldn't have to follow him. It's a spot I wouldn't wish on a leper. All right, so you heard that line before, so it happens to fit the occasion, so a person can always be original. The greatest Hirschfeld stories is about the obnoxious dowager at a ringside table in one of the New York nightclubs. She heckled the entertainers. She cussed out the waiters. She was just awful. The manager of the nightclub sent over a bottle of champagne to her table with his compliments. He gave her a corsage of orchids. Finally, he sent the head waiter with his own wristwatch as a present. but she persisted in being offensive. Someone said to the manager, "How could you give such an obnoxious woman all those gifts?" The manager said, "Look, I know she must be somebody's mother, and I'm so happy she's not mine, she can have anything I've got." Here are more of the stories told by Harry Hirschfeld himself.
In this topsy world of ours, and this running around and rushing into one another, you know, a kid in an aeroplane, and he's running up and down the aisle of the aeroplane, and he's knocking the food out of the hands of the stewardess, and he's taking the pills away from the passengers, and he's knocking the seat. He's a nuisance running up and down the aisle. Finally, the stewardess grabs a hold of this kid and says, "Do me a favor, play outside." You know that in all the years I've delved in humor, ladies and gentlemen, you won't believe how few stories there are complimentary to women. Oh, women laugh at stories about themselves, but they always think maybe it's the other woman, not her. But I've got a story that'll make the men hang their heads in shame because this is complimentary to women. Fellow got married, and after a few months, his wife passed on, and he married for the second time. And he said to the second wife, "You can change the house to suit yourself, but I have a nostalgic feeling for my first wife. Up in the closet, she has her hat. Please don't disturb it." So she promised not to. Well, the second wife passed on, and he married for the third time. And he said to the third wife, "You can change the house to suit yourself, but I have a very sentimental feeling for my first two wives. Their hats are up in the closet. Please don't disturb it." She said, "I won't, but I'll tell you this. The next hat that goes up there will be a derby." Everybody doesn't know about great men. Of course, there's an old saying, no prominent man objects to a story about himself if it's complimentary. But this story happens to be true. I was sitting at the Waldorf Astoria one night, and I was making a talk, and not far from me was sitting President Eisenhower. And I told a story, and when I had finished, he said, "That story is true. Where did you hear it? I didn't think anybody knew it." And here was the story. You know, General Montgomery of the British 8th Army, a very wonderful general, but a very punctilious, meticulous sort of fellow. He's very British, you know, in his talk. And he said to the then General Eisenhower, discussing some sector they were to invade, he said to General Eisenhower, "I say, old man, will you have your troops there in time?" And Eisenhower said, "Don't worry, I'll have them there in schedule." And Montgomery said, "My old man, the word is not schedule. The word is schedule. Schedule. Where did you learn to call it schedule?" And Eisenhower says, "In grammar school." When people think they're important, I like to tell them this story. There was a chicken and a pig in a cart going through the streets. And every restaurant they passed, there was a big sign, "Ham and eggs, ham and eggs, ham and eggs." And the chicken says to the pig, "Oh boy, we're something, we're the headliners. Every restaurant has ham and eggs. We're the headliners." The pig looked at the chicken and said, "Listen, with you, it only means an extra cackle. With me, it's a supreme sacrifice." Everybody has a traffic problem. Every city has a traffic problem. So I have the answer for them. A fellow walked into one of those automobile stores, and he says to the clerk, "Can I buy that very car that's in the window, that car?" He said, "Yes." He said, "What do you want for it?" He said, $6,000. He peeled off the money and he gave it to him. And the clerk says to him, "Shall we deliver it or will you drive it out yourself?" He says, "No, leave it just exactly where it is. I'll never get such a good parking space again."
That was Harry Hirschfeld, another humorist on the American scene. In 1913 saw Americans standing in line to try out the newly established parcel post service. Most of the women looked like they had balloon heads in the latest vogue started by Queen Mary of England, turbans. Ping pong was a new indoor game, but it had to move outdoors. Couldn't compete with the indoor stuff that's been popular since the beginning of time, post office. Oh, what a memory. I was playing at the Palace along with Moran and Mac, the two black crows. Every performance, we'd all crowd into the wings to catch their act. As often as we heard their dialogue, we laughed right along with the audience. I'll never forget Charlie Mack's definition of an alibi. An alibi is proven that you was where you was when you wasn't, and that you wasn't where you was when you was. Ah, but you've got to hear the boys themselves to really appreciate them. Listen.
Doggone it, Amos. You must have traveled restrictively, huh?
Traveled? Boy, I've been all over Europe, Asia, Cincinnati.
Cincinnati, Ojo.
Ojo?
Ohio.
How do you spell it?
Capital O-H-10.
I never been there, but I've been all over Rome.
Well, we used to live in Rome. We had a farm in Rome.
Well, what did you raise on your farm?
Oh, we only raised grouper feathers, that's about it.
Grouper feathers?
Yeah, for the king's pillow. Didn't you ever sleep on grouper feathers?
Well, I never heard of them.
Oh, they are so soft.
Grouper feathers? Why, what are they made of?
The fuzz from peaches. And we used to grow pigs.
Grow your own pigs?
Well, we used to buy young pigs in August, and then we'd sell them in April.
What did you pay for the pigs in August?
A certain amount.
Yes, I know, but how much?
$4 each.
And what did you sell them for in April?
$4 each.
You paid $4 in August and sold them in April for $4?
Yes.
Well, you can't make any money that way.
No, we found that out. we have 8 horses.
Oh, you have 8 horses?
No, not 8 horses. A horses. We found out the white horses eat more than black horses, so we sold all the white horses.
The white horses eat more than the black horses?
Yeah, the white ones eat more.
Oh, that's silly. Why should the white horses eat more than the black horses?
We couldn't figure any reason unless it was because we had more of the white horses.
Well, did you have any chickens?
We had 1,000 chickens and 999 laid eggs.
What's the matter with the other one?
He's head man.
Well, boy, I'm going down to feed the pigs, so I'll meet you down at the pig pen.
Yeah. You better keep your hat on so I'll know you.
You just heard the two black crows, Moran and Mack, two of the greatest comedians of the century. For a guy who never went past the sixth grade, it's amazing that Georgie Jessel has such a vocabulary. He's become so expert as a speaker that one of our presidents dubbed him Toastmaster General of the United States. I go back with Georgie to one of Gus Edwards' kid acts in the year 1912. 1912, imagine. I knew Georgie before he knew about girls. Right now, he's one of the most married men in Hollywood. Jessel walks around with a marriage license made out to him and to whom it may concern. But Georgie tells me he's going to marry again very soon. And this time he said it's going to take, because he's marrying someone a little bit more mature. I only hope that Georgie Jessel and Sophie Tucker will be very happy. What first made Jessel a hit were his one-way telephone conversations with his mother. Listen.
Hello, Mama. Ed, this is your son, Georgie. Where do you think I'm phoning from? Hollywood, long distance. Of course it's expensive, but I'm visiting. I'm at Eddie Cantor's house. Yeah. How are you feeling? Oh, you do? You see spots in front of your eyes. Well, why don't you wear your glasses? They're up on your forehead. Well, it isn't the Brooklyn Bridge. You just pull them down. You got the glasses on? How is it? You see the spots better with the glasses. I see. Look, Mom, how did you like that birthday present I sent you? That beautiful bird. You what? You cooked it? A mother that was a South American parrot. He speaks five languages. He should have said something. Okay. How's my sweet little brother, Willie? He's a bad boy again, huh? Well, what did he do? Well, you forgive him because he doesn't feel good. What's the matter? Pains in his stomach. Well, that's simple, Mother. Why don't you give him some of those pills that I have in my medicine chest? You know how to do it. If he takes the pills, you put 25 cents in his bank. Oh, he found out it's the gas meter. I see. But you fooled him anyway? What'd you do? You put the pills in a banana, and he just ate the banana. That was very bright of you, Mom. Put him on the phone. Hi, Willie. Well, you're going to feel better now, son. You bet. Did you eat the banana? Everything but the seeds. I see. Well, put your sister Anna on the phone. Hello? Anna? Look, honey, I know this isn't the time nor the place to lecture you, but after all, I'm your oldest brother and I love you dearly. And if I'm not thinking of your future, so who is going to do it, Anna? What's going to be with that fella of yours? You're getting married in December. How do you know? He said it'd be a cold day when he marries you. Well, you love him. Why do you love him so much? Because he's so kind-hearted. How do you know he's kind-hearted? When he goes in the streets, the dogs lick his hands? If he'd eat once with a knife and fork, they wouldn't do that. Yeah, well, put your mother back on. Hello, Mom. I just talked to her. Well, what are you going to do with her? Let her get as much out of life as she can. You know what Longfellow says? Tell me not in mournful numbers, life is but an empty dream. I say Longfellow said that. I shouldn't go around with him. He's drunk. No. Henry Wadsworth Longfellow, the poet. He didn't live next door to us at all, Mother. That was Lowenstein, a bookmaker who... That's who lived next door to us. Yeah. Well, okay, dear. No, I can't talk much longer now. Yeah, I will. And give your love to Eddie Cantor. Goodbye, dear.
You just heard Georgie Gissel in one of his very funny Hello Mama routines. Well, you have just been listening to the greatest comedians of the century. To you older folks, I'm sure it gave you a few good laughs and a tug at your heart. To you youngsters, you've no doubt noticed where some of the jokes of today came from. They came from the greatest comedians of the century.